Welcome back, friends, to another session of fluid mechanics and rate processes. So we are at a very interesting stage of this course where we are trying to put together all that we have learned so far in looking at the viscous flows. Let's start. So we want to talk about boundary lengths. Let me review for you what we studied about this concept of boundary layer. So let me first begin with the example of a flat plate. I'll give you two examples, a flat plate and then an airfoil. So this is a uniform flow coming into the flat plate, and then I could get a boundary layer, right? So this region is the viscous region. If the Reynolds number is fairly high, and the outer region is the inviscid region. If I try to draw a velocity profile, let's say I draw a velocity profile at this station, then what I would find is that outside the boundary layer, I have almost a uniform flow. So this is the profile. And then inside, of course, it respects the no slip boundary condition. So you have the boundary layer. Likewise for flow past an airfoil. So if I had flow coming in to an airfoil, then I would have a region where the shear stresses are large, the viscous effects are large. And if I drew a profile, let's say somewhere here, then what I would see is some kind of an inviscid flow outside and then a boundary layer on the inside. So this region we are referring to as the boundary layer. So I should mark here. This is where the viscous effects are important. So this is the viscous region, and the outside region is the inviscid region. If I wanted to analyze any of these two flows or some flows which are similar to this, I really had two options. Option one is I take the full Navier-Stokes equations, apply my boundary conditions, which would be for a flat plate, velocity is 0 here, far away the effect of flat plate is not there, free stream conditions, and solve the full Navier-Stokes. Do the same thing for an airfoil, right? But then we have already seen how complex the Navier-Stokes equations are. They are difficult to solve. So the engineering solution to this problem is to split it into two smaller problems. We perhaps could model the inviscid region by the Euler equations, which are for inviscid flows. And these, of course, could be simplified to potential flows if I can further show that this flow is irrotational. And as we know, the potential flow is really easy to solve. Okay, only one unknown. The equation is del square phi equal to 0. And we've already seen flow past a circular cylinder, a spinning cylinder. We could do that for airfoils and so on. So this part is easy. We could do the same thing for an airfoil. And inside this zone where the viscous effects are important, we could actually get something called boundary layer equations. So I will now solve two sets of equations. The easy equations, the Euler equations or the potential flow equations. I would really like to solve the potential flow equations if that is applicable. But if the flow is rotational, the outer flow is rotational, then I would have to solve the Euler equations. And then I solve the boundary layer equations in the inside and match the two solutions. Okay, so that's the recipe that we are going to follow. So today in this session, we are going to derive the boundary layer equations. I have already given you a foundation of that in the earlier classes, but today we are going to follow that up with more rigor. So let us assume that we are dealing with a two-dimensional flow, although these equations would be valid for three dimensions as well. We will further assume that we have an incompressible flow. We will also assume that the flow is steady. All these assumptions can be relaxed, but then the equations will become slightly more complicated at each step. So we want to avoid that and look at the most basic analysis. Okay. And we are also going to assume no body forces. So for this situation, I can now try to take the Navier-Stokes equations and then push in some assumptions and derive the boundary layer equations. That's the first thing that we want to do. We are interested in a situation where this assumption is valid, boundary layer equations are valid, and for that we will need the following. So first is, we will assume there is no flow separation. Because if the flow separates, then we will see that the boundary layer assumption itself breaks down. Then you cannot divide the flow into an outer flow and an inner flow. Then actually this kind of a difference between two regimes would become very murky, and we cannot really do that. So no flow separation. And B, we are really talking about a situation where this region is thin. Okay, so the viscous region is very narrow. That would happen, we have shown in an earlier session, that we are dealing with high Reynolds number such that my delta, the boundary layer thickness, so this here for example is the boundary layer thickness. Of course, it's a function of x. Similarly, in the airfoil, the boundary layer thickness is a function of x. So we are saying that delta by L, if it's a characteristic length, for example, for the airfoil, I could take the chord of the airfoil. That's much smaller than 1. And we've seen that in an earlier session. So I showed you the thickness of a boundary layer on the wing of an Airbus A320 when it is in cruise. It was really of the order of a millimeter, very tiny. And another assumption that we are going to make is that the curvature effects are neglected. So either we have a flat surface, or even if we have a curved surface, it's a very gentle curvature. So I could actually assume that x coordinate is along the surface of the airfoil, and the curvature is so gentle that I can actually think of it as a flattened out airfoil surface. Okay? So with these assumptions, what I am going to do is write down the Navier-Stokes equations, and then we'll do some kind of a order of magnitude analysis, throw away the terms which are not so large as some of the other terms, and we'll get simplified equations. So we will use what is called non-dimensionalization. We've done this many times before, and part of what I have done today, we have done in an earlier session, but no harm in repeating that to drive home the point. So we are going to say that x star is the non-dimensional x coordinate, and that is given by non-dimensionalized with a characteristic length of L. Y star, because we are inside the boundary layer, L may not be the correct characteristic length, it actually is the boundary layer thickness. So this would be given as y divided by delta. And we already know that delta is expected to be much smaller than capital L. Same thing with Vx. Vx star is the non-dimensional streamwise speed, which is with the free stream speed. So u is the free stream speed at far away from the body. We don't know how to non-dimensionalize Vy. So we are going to assume that this is given as something by Uy, and Uy is to be determined. In fact, that will come right out of this analysis magically. We don't know what the role of pressure exactly would be, but for the time being, let's say P star is the non-dimensional pressure, which is given as P divided by rho u square. So that's the free stream dynamic pressure. Okay, so let's write down the three equations. So first the continuity equation, then the x momentum equation, and then the y momentum equation. And we will first write the dimensional forms and then the non-dimensional form. So continuity equation, del Vx by del x plus del Vy by del y, this is 0. The x momentum equation, rho Vx del Vx by del x plus Vy del Vx by del y. So that's the convective term. Then I'm going to write down the pressure term, and this is equal to the Laplacian of the x component of velocity, which is del square Vx by del x square plus del square Vx by del y square. So that's your x momentum equation. The y momentum equation, again the convection term, so this time it is Vx del Vy by del x plus Vy del Vy by del y. Then the pressure gradient, that would be del P del y, and this is mu del square Vy by del x square plus del square Vy by del y square. Essentially, this term is just the Laplacian of the y component of velocity. So let me number these. This is 1, 2, and 3. Now I will try to non-dimensionalize them. So that's easy. For Vx, I am going to replace it with Vx star times u, and for x, I am going to replace it with x star times L. Okay? So let's do the x momentum equation first. And you can see that would be essentially u divided by L del Vx star by del x star. That's my first term. And now I come to the second term. So for Vy, I am using Uy as my characteristic speed. And for the y, I am using delta. So this becomes del Vy star by del y star equal to 0. There are two terms in this equation. Okay? They have to be of the same order. I cannot have two terms and say one term is significantly larger than the other. In fact, it has to be exactly equal to the other. So if I am just interested in the order of magnitude analysis, not their size, then I would like to argue that because this is non-dimensional, so this term is of the order of 1. And similarly, I have non-dimensionalized Vy with Uy, so therefore it is of the order of 1. Similarly, Y is non-dimensionalized with delta. So again, this term is of the order of 1. Order does not mean it is exactly equal to 1, but it's something like it could be 5, it could be 3, it could be 5.7, and so on. So there you go. I have this term of the order of 1, this term of the order of 1. That means these coefficients should be similar. And right away I can see that my Uy is therefore of the order of, or rather I can say order of UY is delta by L capital U. I already know delta is very small compared to L. So, what this means is that my speed in the y direction is much smaller than u. So, this tells me that uy is much, much smaller than capital U. Okay? Let's come down to the x momentum equation. So, the x momentum equation tells me I am going to now take the first term, so that's rho, and for vx I get u and then l and another u, so this would be vx star del vx star by del x star. So that's my first term. For the second term, now for vy I am going to substitute vy as uy times vy star, but uy I already know it's delta by L u. Okay? So, I am going to straight away write down this delta by L u times a vy star, and then I have for del vx by del y as u divided by delta delta v x star by del y star. Okay, that's my second term, and now I'm going to write down my pressure gradient term, so that would be rho u square by l del p star by del x star. And now I come down to my viscous terms. Okay. So the first viscous term is I get a u by L square, and that would be del square Vx star by del x star square. Plus the second term would be given as, now there's a by y square, so that would be u by delta square del square vx star by del y star square. Okay. Now I'm going to divide the whole equation, so divide by rho u square by L, and let's see what I get out of this equation. So this stays as it is, Vx star del Vx star by del X star. This I get, you know, these deltas they cancel out. Sorry, there was a rho here as well. Okay, I missed out on the rho on the convective term. So that also goes away. So I am going to get Vy star times del Vx star by del y square. I am going to lose the coefficient here also. I have divided by rho u square by L. So this is del p star by del x star. And now I come to this term. So I will have the following. So this would be mu divided by rho, and I am dividing by u square, so there is one u and then an L, and this would be del Vx star by del x star square. Okay. How about the next term? The next term would be mu divided by rho u L. So I would like to retain this kind of a form, and the remaining terms as you would see are L square by delta square del square Vx star by del y star square. Great. This term, as you would recollect, is actually the Reynolds number. So I am going to write down as 1 divided by Reynolds number. So Reynolds number is defined as rho u l divided by mu. And this is also the same term, so 1 by Reynolds number. And this, of course, is a very large term, because L square is going to be much larger than delta square. So let's see how we argue. Convection, pressure, viscous. We are inside a boundary layer. So viscous terms have to be important. Okay, so we cannot throw them away. Now the argument is, these are non-dimensional terms, so they are of the order of 1. Okay. Likewise, these terms are of the order of 1, pressure also along the pressure gradient along the x direction. So all these terms are of the order of 1. I cannot have viscous terms which are larger than order of 1. Because if I had those terms to be larger than 1, then I must have something to balance them. Okay. So otherwise this equation is just not going to work out. Okay. So I will have to have both these terms of the order of 1 or less. Of course, one of these terms could be very small, but both viscous terms combined should be of the order of these terms to balance the equation out. Okay, let's argue. This is of the order of 1, I suppose. But then this term is extremely small because my Reynolds number is very large. So this term is very small, 1 by Re. On the other hand, this L square by delta square is very large. So therefore, this term I can drop because this is much, much less than 1. And I would like the viscous term to be of the order of 1. And if this term is of the order of 1, then I can conclude that the product of this and 1 by Re should be of the order of 1. So therefore, this implies, these two terms, they actually imply that L square delta square times 1 by Re should be of the order of 1, which really means that delta by L is of the order of 1 by square root Re. So magically, just from non-dimensional analysis, I am able to get what is the thickness of the boundary layer. And that turns out to be very small. Okay, delta by L is varying as 1 by square root of Re. And we did see this in one of the earlier sessions, that for the wing of an Airbus, okay, this was of the order of a millimeter, when the chord of the wing was of the order of several meters.